Yosin.
All right.
What's up? We're here with number 4 this time of our Blair Witch series. If you guys want to check out our other ones, go right over here. You'll see them up there. You know, we have 1 through 3. Game's a lot of fun. We're going to hop straight into number 4.
Yeah. See what they got for us, dude. The unboxing. Nine items.
Get that. Ooh.
Letter from Rosemary. Carver's message.
Feel this.
Anthony's note.
Ooh,
Historical reenactment script.
Okay.
Account of search party expedition.
You got a compass?
What the hell?
Oh, it says something. Each square an hour.
Yeah, compass, magnifying glass, Black Hills forest map, building records.
What's this?
Each square an hour.
What's the goal of this one? To complete this episode, check all documents and items for clues, decipher all coded messages, help Rosemary complete her objective.
Is this a magnifying glass?
Yes, that's what it says.
That is what it says.
Alright.
It's kind of cool. Right,
cool.
It's got a little pocket.
So, open shut up.
So, letter from Rosemary. We'll do that first, right? The one in here?
Yeah, Rosemary is the last person we talked to, so.
Okay.
And this is a poster I can hang on my wall.
Ooh. So we got a full map.
Big ol' map.
Alright, well, I'll hop straight into it. So, letter from Rosemary. Hello.
No.
Carver left me another message a few nights ago. He left a note right on my front doorstep. Of all the sick, invasive, downright evil things to do, hasn't this son of a bitch done enough to me? When will I have suffered enough? When I think about him slithering around in the woods, looking at my house from the tree line and peering into my windows... My head gets light and I get so nauseated that I feel as though I might be dying. I can't sleep at all anymore. Every night I just sit up on the porch or in Tristan's bed with Hud's old shotgun in my lap until the sun finally rises. Sometimes I'll hear a noise in the night and run toward it, finally ready to pull the trigger on this lunatic, but it's only ever the wind. I haven't shown Laning Carver's message. Is that the cop?
Yeah.
Sheriff? It'll just get sent off to some lab where it'll gather dust on a shelf for months, if not years. Even if it gets fast-tracked, what good will it do? The sheriff's office already knows where he is, and they're still not finding him. The forest is too huge and confusing for them to handle. It's time to take this completely into my own hands like I should have from the beginning. There's no point in spending another second in this house or this town. My sons aren't here. They're in that forest. Carver's only gotten cockier over these last few months. At this point, he wants me to come out and find him. Something in that note has to give us some sort of context as to where he's hiding. Luckily, even if the lead is obscure, we've got a bona fide expert on the Black Hills Forest on our side. It took a while to convince Anthony to help me collect what we need.
That's the historian guy.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. He kept trying to talk me down at first. Eventually, I had to grab him by the shoulders, look him dead in the eyes, and tell him that there's already one man standing between me and my sons, that one man is already too many, and that friendship or not, I'm prepared to bring that number to 0 by any means necessary. That finally convinced him to relent. Anthony gathered most of what I'm sending to you from the museum attic. He said that since the forest is too dangerous, my best chance of making a successful journey out there was to study the accounts of people who made trips deep into the woods and lived to tell the tale. You'll need to cross-reference the map with the historical events Anthony has given us and find the location of Carver's hiding place. When you figure it out, send the correct map coordinates on the tip line, kentcase.com. New password is echo12.
Cool, okay, so we need, for this
even
one...
Even though I'm going to be totally out there, I have faith that the help I get from the outside is going to see me through. Rosemary.
Okay, so we need to, to solve this one, find his hiding place on this map here.
Cross-referencing historical accounts.
Yes. It's a big boy.
Okay,
Burkittsville, letters across.
Creekside Timber Co. Outpost and the Creekside Timber Co. Alright.
So we got a cross-reference, like you said. I got a letter from Anthony this time, so we'll read that next. Investigator, since Rosemary is truly hellbent on doing this, and you're the one who's managed to help her get this far already, I'm going to do everything in my power to arm the both of you with as much information as possible. I collected a few things I think will help you navigate the forest. 3 historical documents, a map, a magnifying glass, and a compass.
Mm-hmm.
The 3 historical documents have each been taken from the museum's archives. I'm including them because they each convey the experience of someone who spent a prolonged period of time in the forest and came out more or less intact. I hope they'll provide some guidance on how to get your bearings in the woods and how to navigate between 3 of its major landmarks in particular once you do. I imagine the map and its accompanying instruments will be useful on that front as well. As far as I am aware, the map itself is the most geographically accurate account of the forest to date. That's including satellite imagery. Digital imaging of the area has always proven to be a challenge. There's actually a very interesting history behind the map and the man who made it. Emmanuel Ramos was a renowned surveyor and cartographer who was hired by a now defunct sawmill to chart out the area in 1953. After a number of the facility's employees began to complain that none of the maps of the area were accurate. As the story goes, Ramos became obsessed with the forest during that period. When he turned in the map, he told sawmill officials that traditional directions don't work in the forest and that instead travelers had to move according to the cues that the land itself gives them. He said he considered the cues to be cardinal. That's probably a big hint.
Yeah, cues being cardinal?
So, north, south, east, west. Don't actually look at the map type thing. That's essentially what he's saying, right? That strikes me as a melodramatic way to describe the cartographic process, but I suppose that he earned the right at that point, seeing as he successfully charted a region that had confounded his colleagues for centuries. The record on Ramos gets a little hazy after that. He completely fell off the map, so to speak, within a year of completing the project. The compass and magnifying glass I'm passing on to you belong to Ramos as well. Maybe using them will help you see the forest the same way he did. It's probably a big hint as well.
Okay.
Alright, I admit that I'm rambling on about obscure historical facts so that I don't have to put my feelings into words, detective. I want you to know that Rosemary is the strongest person I've ever met. She's managed to stand so tall for so long in the face of such unbelievable loss, but at the end of the day, she's only human, and the forces she's going up against aren't. Please do the best you can to see her through this. Anthony.
Jeez. So, when you said that about the compass, I looked on the deck, and etched in there, it says each square an hour.
Yeah, each square takes an hour to travel. So there's going to be something that has to do with time, and then we'll put it together.
Well,
one of these squares, because it's broken up into squares.
Yeah. And like they said in the past, it's
so 14 hours.
Moves differently.
Yeah, I know. I mean, the forest, a weird timing happens. Yeah. Okay.
Let me look at this real quick.
I could dive into this little. This looks like it's 2 rosemary as well.
And what's this?
Some
house?
Yes, some cool house thingy with some messages on the inside.
Man, whoever made this game, you like reading.
We love reading.
I chose to be a musician. We make our decisions, I guess. Alright, what are we going with next? Are you going with Carver's note?
I got a bunch of notes here, too.
I'll dive right in. This is a rosemary? I don't know if Jim Carver does say that. I don't know.
No, that's... the code.
Yeah, there's more code. Okay. Rosemary. The boys keep calling out into the woods for you, and you never answer them. You've really been letting them down over these past few months, haven't you? In fact, you've been letting them down for their entire lives. Never been able to protect them, to comfort them, to realize the depth of their pain. At least now you'll never be able to fail them again. Either. Holy shit. Alright. Remember when you would play hide and seek with Liam when he was little? How he would always hide in the roots of that gnarled old tree at the very edge of the forest? I'd watch from the tree line, seeing you pretend to search everywhere, even though he always hid in the same place. I'm sure you wish it was that easy now, but this game is going to be a fair measure more challenging. You're not going to be able to just waltz into the woods and stumble upon the light of my campfire. That's not what she wants. She wants you to suffer, and so do I. But if you're smart enough, maybe you'll be able to find your way to your sons. Maybe you'll even get a glimpse of your dear old HUD, the husband that killed himself knocking down the tree. Yeah, HUD. Oh, and in case you haven't figured it out yet, there's a reason that your search parties have failed to find me for so long. Sunlight conceals the truth of the forest. To see the light of my fire, you'll have to enter after dark. I don't need to tell you to come by yourself. I already know you will. And then there's just coding.
All we're
dude,
gonna
that's
code.
Gash. Yeah, you do all about the code, so you dive in.
I already pulled it out.
So,
here from last time.
Do I dive in or do you dive in? I got one more over here.
I got a play, so whenever you want me to throw the Shakespeare out,
you'll
let me
know. Wow, you have a whole play. Are you serious? You have a whole script?
Not like, you know, I mean, it's not the whole play.
Say, because if you're going to put on a show for us, let me read first. All right, so I'm diving in the next letter, right?
I'll work on the code while you do that.
I'm going to read everything. This looks like this is like the letter hasn't started yet, so... I've sewn a few journal pages of a young man named Aloysius Masters for you. Mr. Masters was a member of a search party that combed through the forest for a number of days in the late 19th century, making several valuable, though largely unconfirmed and inexplainable, observations along the way. It's like it's written in a weird handwriting, so that's why I'm having a hard time.
Oh,
right?
It's Anthony. He's the one who's.
Oh, okay. Master's journal were passed down through his family for years before being donated to the museum by a great-great-granddaughter who was moving out of the town and didn't want to carry much of the past with her. Hopefully her loss will be your gain. Dash A. And that's why he said it's from Anthony. And then now this is the beginning of the letter, March 14th, 1886. And this is, like, super little small cursive writing. Back in town now. Spent the day out in the forest once again. Traveled several hours past the bone white rock where we ended our search yesterday, but still to no... If, I think this is a veil? A veil, yeah. We 14... able-bodied men volunteered from about town who know the area and its peculiarities have not been able to find any sign that another human being has ever been in there in the woods at all. It was tragic yet not unsurprising when that young girl became lost in the forest. It still disturbed me to the utmost degree, however, to think that the forest group of men sent to search for her should disappear as well. I'm sorry, I'm butchering the shit out of this. We the 14 members of the second search party count our friends and brothers and sons amongst the lost, and we have found neither hair nor hide of them, and not of the girl herself for 2 days now. The only discovery of note thus far was that of a paddle of some vicious. I don't know what that word says. It's such a small handwriting, dude. Maybe this is what this is for. Maybe I'm supposed to be zooming in on it, dude. Holy
yeah.
Shit! I'm sitting here holding this thing. Where did I leave off? Where did I leave off? Of some vicious that none of us could rightly identify, which one man, son of a bitch, I don't know what that says, weaving with this, something lost a boot to when he accidentally stumbled into it. Though I do not put much stock in the ghost stories. That's unreadable. That word is okay. You try to take it, bro. I don't know if I'm just shitting the bed right now or if it's that hard to read.
We, the 14 members of the second search party, count our friends and brothers and sons amongst the lost, and we have we have found neither hair no hide of them, and not of the girl herself for 2 days now. The only discovery of note thus far was that of a puddle of some. Wow, this is really.
Yeah, give it your best bet. You're doing better than I was. So I think they're supposed to be like that. Some of the words are so poorly written that
vicious substance, I guess. That none. None of us could slightly rightly identify which one.
All right, I'm just glad it's not me. Yeah, you guys, we're doing our best to put this together for you guys. We're going to put it up on the screen so you guys can try to see what it says, too. But there's a lot of handwritten words, and we're butchering it. And it's been written in the 1886, so it's tough to read for you guys. But we're going to put it up on the screen.
Here's the best part about Yosin. We can do fast-forwarding.
Yeah.
Saving time.
And that's what we're going to
have. What we're going to do right
that's
now.
That's too funny.
So I'm going to read this.
Time lapse.
I got to like the second page in that time lapse, so I hope you enjoyed. I was wasting your time. I'm sorry. Basically, on the first day, they found nothing. A guy slipped into mud. On the second day, he came in with some boots he borrowed because he put his boots over fire all night, and the substance was still there. Second day, they found a human tooth at a white tree.
The white tree, probably.
The white tree.
Yeah, the
And
white
the third day, the guy that found the tooth wouldn't come back to the search, wouldn't speak to anyone. And that's where I got. And that's when Brandon came in with some knowledge.
I had a couple thoughts. Mainly, I figured out the code. The code is, find us where a shred of propriety was lost. And then I thought to myself, okay, we have to figure out his hiding spot. Putting two and two together, you're reading expedition notes. So we got to find where the white tree is, probably.
Yeah, he's just saying he's got an expedition going. The back of this says each square an hour. So we're thinking that we have to track that expedition on this map according to this amount of speed per square. So that's our idea so far. We still have a bit yet to read, right, though, because you might want to go through that, and then I'm going to dive into this, and we also have a play, so.
Well, we should do one part by one part,
honestly. Yeah, no, you keep going with that, yeah.
Well, I'm not going to, like, read it out.
Oh.
Yeah, I think we should just try to kind of go through this and see where they went. So it just says they started in the forest. They spent the day in the forest.
So some forest.
Ooh, there's something written on here.
Where's this?
The forks here? Of light. Lightning erupt from the clear sky. Here, I saw the eyeless creatures hoard their bones.
Oh, there's a bunch of words on this thing. Through the sun moves through the sky. The shadows of the pines stay fixed in place.
I hear not whispers to climb to the oak trees and leap into the air, but I will not give in. The crows feed at blood-red dusk. Oh, this is in circle.
He says deep underground
here
ancient
the vermin
roots
fester
through shattered skulls? Holy shit. That's
here the heavy. Vermin fester in the bleak sunlight. But dance under the light of the moon. Didn't he say something about darkness?
Dude, look at lost souls weep from nostalgia and regret. It says that on the road. Oh my god.
The heavy limbs of trees are seared with claw marks and carvings.
Ooh.
I want to say we're getting close up here. The ground with its dreadful mermaids will cradle careless travelers for eternity.
Tears of the drowned ceaselessly flow down the creek. I don't know.
It's right here.
Oh, what did that say? Wait. Yeah, that's what I read before. Though the sun moves through the sky, the shadows of the pines stay fixed in place.
And then that.
As I read that one too. That's the deep underground ancient roots wind through shattered skulls.
The sky shines bright. I don't know what that word is. The sun and moon are nowhere to be seen.
Okay, so either way, we were just trying to find out the starting point on this. Somewhere in the forest, and none of those necessarily say we
no,
started here.
That was not helpful.
Yeah, none of those really say we started here, so.
We need something else, I suppose.
Let's go back to that.
Okay.
Came across a large white rock again. We're about to get out from the stone when I noticed a familiar sound. Listened closely to locate the source of the sound, and I thought it eluded me. It soon became apparent the sound itself was that of a man calling for help. I turned to my left toward Josiah, but saw another man instead. Mr. Johnson was now standing to my right. Although I had not once moved from my course, nor had I seen another man cross my path. When I attempted to alert Mr. Johnson and the others of the noise, no other man seemed to be able to hear it, though it was only increasing in volume and desperation. Despite this, the men were aware to me that the forest was silent as the grave. It was then I began to hear the voice screaming at my name. Oh, screaming out my name. I insisted that we follow it. I must have deemed either quite, desperate, because Mr. Johnson agreed to break from our planned course from where we stood at the large white rock.
I'm going to assume that's
the white rock. I'm going to go ahead and just go.
Or at least that's a hill.
It's a hill, yeah, they're all
white rock. We followed the stream toward the sound I heard. Almost as soon as we changed course, we came across a pile of dead rodents.
Where does it say rodents? Here the vermin fester in the bleak sunlight.
So they started here and went all the way over there?
Yeah.
Okay.
They appear to have died fighting one another.
Yep, they dance and under the moonlight.
As their flesh was mangled to shreds. We walked 2 hours in the same direction.
What? So they went way up? Okay.
The smell of their rot seeming to linger with us long after we had passed them. Then as we neared a fork in the stream.
Oh, we neared a fork in the stream.
Okay.
Huh?
I don't know.
They passed the fork in the stream. They're up here. If they went 2 more hours.
Well,
after
we did. They just said they found the rodents. They might not be on the rodent square. Maybe it's just all in this area.
Yeah.
Maybe it was like right over here or something.
Maybe.
So the fork in the road. That's obviously the fork, unless it's this. But it's gotta be that. Or this.
Fork in the stream. We sighted a wisp of smoke in the distance at an angle from our current course. It surprised us all, especially myself. I have been a resident of the town of Burkittsville for the better part of 20 years.
I hear whispers in something of the oak trees and leap into the air, but I will not give in. That's right here.
See, with the exceptions of wives' tales, there have been no accounts of anyone taking up residence this far out in the woods. We turned slightly to head toward the voice. We traveled 3 hours through ancient oak trees.
3 hours through ancient
oak. I remember thinking the sound of the wind through the trees had... The trees something sounded not unlike the whispering of an old woman. And then I realized that I did not feel any wind upon my face. I was about to comment on the strange phenomenon of the weird of the wind to the other men when I spotted the cabin. The home was a small structure in ill repair. The smoke we had been lingered in a huge around the house. I don't know. Lingered in a haze around the house, though we could not see its source.
I put you somewhere over here.
There's somewhere over there.
Like, at fork of trees. This is the whispering right here. This.
Let's see. We went closer to inspect, which, I don't know, us to navigate away. Short other uphill terrain? I don't know.
Uphill terrain?
Mm-hmm. No, they say that's going up a hill.
No. Stretch of hill terrain.
This is hill.
Stretch of...
Mm-hmm.
These are hills.
Okay, a short stretch of hill terrain.
Right here.
Stretch.
The short stretch.
One sight line of the house was interrupted by one of these hills. And
so Fork, when you went this way through the trees, hill blocking your view. Is it right here?
I don't know.
Keep going.
When we managed to invest the hill to all, oh man, and negate what should have been a direct sight line, the structure was gone. We searched the entire area, but not a single one could find any trace of the cabin again. The stream of emote remained in sky. Oh, the stream of smoke remained in the sky directly above where the cabin should have been. Mr. Johnson insisted that the sighting of the cabin and the smoke must have been no more than a trick of our minds, experienced by many men due to our desperation. Though I took a small delight in not being the only man glimpsing some sort of phenomena, I could not help but think of Thomas Gillard sitting in the safety of his home. This is honestly so stupid.
This one, it says, here I saw the eyeless creatures hoard their bones.
Yeah, this one still says, deep underground ancient roots wind through shattered stones.
I'm just trying to think, what if they went like this? And then went like this? Because that's a fork in the road, yeah. So they went like this. Fork. I don't know.
Well, they were at the rock, and then they found a fork.
That's technically a hill.
Yeah, I don't know. Okay.
Two members of our party vanished during our search. The first was Mr. Robertson, who seemingly disappeared into thin air half an hour after we crossed into the wood. Some other man turned to call for him, I do not recall who, and then that calling intensified to a frenzy, and soon the whole search party was running about searching for him. Some suggested he may have turned coward and headed home to Mrs. Gillard, or as Mr. Gillard had. But a moment later, we set eyes upon a small bundle of sticks wound with a set of slime-covered boot laces.
Ooh.
Mr. Michaels disappeared shortly after. He volunteered to head back to town to see if he could find Mr. Robertson. As it turns out, he never completed his journey. When the remaining 11 of us returned to the end of a fruitless day, it was to the screaming and hysteria of the town. Apparently, sometime during the excursion, someone had placed small wooden effigies in the shape of men on the doorstep of Robertson's and Michael's homes. Though I did not know either.
That's creepy. So he killed them and then made a figure of them. Just like how he made a figure of Liam.
Mm-hmm. Last night, I dreamt that I was alone in the woods. In the dead of the night, as I stumbled around the dark, I noticed that two lights in the distance, they hovered among the trees for a long moment before being swatted out. Leaving me totally alone once again, I cannot help but believe them to be the souls of Robertson and Michaels, lost minds that labyrinth would, perhaps they were a pair of eyes. I woke this morning covered in sweat, with two small principles upon my neck. Pimples? I don't know. This is where, this is terrible writing.
Yeah.
They continuously bleed. So he had two small pimples or something like that on his neck. They continuously bleed no matter the amount of pressure that he places on them. He tells himself again and again that it's nothing. And
they like bite marks?
I don't know. Spot where I had pricked myself upon a thorn or a branch during yesterday's search. After summoning all of my remaining courage, I joined the search party once again. We numbered 5 in total today. Half of the remaining men have refused to join again. About 3 hours into the day, Mr. Johnson claimed to have caught sight of a boot print. My hopes were
momentarily lifted, and I ran to seize Discovery. However, I tripped on the way over and hit my mouth on a rock that lay in the forest floor, biting my tongue as I fell. My mouth filled with blood, which soon began to dribble out of, onto my clothing. I soon realized that the rock had knocked one of my front teeth out of my mouth, although I could not find it anywhere on the forest floor. Perhaps I swallowed it in my confusion and pain.
Didn't they find a human tooth in the tree?
Yeah, they did. Mm-hmm. To add insult to energy, it soon became apparent there had been no boot print on the ground after all. The men did what they could to aid me, but we decided to call the day's search shoot as we deemed it too separate and allow me to return to the town alone. We returned a minute before, I don't know, although there should have been all account been hours of daylight remaining. I have waited several days to collect myself, and I feel as though it is time that I recount what our party discovered on the seventh day of our search. We did indeed find the missing men from the first search party, but it was in no condition any man should be found. I would not wish the violence that was inflicted upon them upon my worst enemy. We discovered them by the same large white rock that we saw on our very first day of searching the woods. They were long dead and had been butchered like animals, all laid out upon the rock in some unmatched formation that I can only assume be some of satanic, it matches the symbols drawn onto their bodies in intermingling blood. The authorities have arranged a search for a madman or men and posted guards on the road to town. The guards are to remain there at all hours, but something tells me the perpetrators will evade their grasp. Something tells me they cannot be grasped at all. And that's the men in the formation.
And a star.
Yeah. Gotta be honest.
That's creepy.
This is hard as fuck. This part.
I gotta take points away from this game. I mean, I know they're trying to make it hard, but this is just like this is like unreadable. This is not fun. So definitely would work on that. What do we do next? Is that
and that was old timey too. I mean, yeah. It definitely fit, but it wasn't easy.
No.
Alright, is this or is this
scene? This and this.
Yeah, there's a picture, there's a lot of different stuff on here. It says plaster interior, she told me the spot. Cement exterior, she needs a basement. She expects company soon.
Flip it over the other side.
Stone foundation, stick built desk, whatever. Window in the attic, she wants me to build. Alright, diving into the inside of this thing. I'll start here. This looks like another letter from Anthony because it just says dash A. This is an architectural drawing complete with a series of handwritten notes that's been on a file at the museum ever since Kipp's Hardware Depot collapsed in the mid-1940s due to a devastating infestation of parasites and mold that the original owners couldn't afford to repair. The lot stood empty until Mike and Bob's convenience store was built in 1951. It pains me to part with this piece of local history, but I don't think that anybody at the museum besides me will even notice its absence, and I know that you're going to put it to good use. Dash A, so I can assume that's Anthony. This is to Mr. Kipp from Ned. A fellow stopped by the store as I was closing up just now. Damn near gave me a heart attack since I could have swore that I already locked the front door. It was that guy who's been living out in the woods. Can't for the life of me remember his name, even though I swear that he introduced himself to me. He bought supplies, nails, shingles, things like that. Said that his place was a damn near falling apart. Drew me a picture and made some notes so that I could get an idea of the scope of the project. said he might come tomorrow morning for more supplies. Wanted to give you a heads up about it in case you're the only one in, because frankly, he doesn't seem to be entirely right in the head. He was caked in dirt, and there were all manners of rotting leaves and pieces of sticks tangled in his beard, and he kept trailing off in the middle of his sentences. But surprisingly, he had enough money, and with the way business has been lately, I could hardly turn a customer away. And that was from Ned. It says, P.S. Where'd all the scrap paper that we usually keep under the counter go? I went to look for something to write a note on, but this drawing was the only paper on hand. This is from Mr. Kipton, Ned again. You're not going to believe this. Just now I was supposed to... Oh, what the... Wait, what?
This is Ned to Mr. Kip.
Oh, I was going to say, but they started off the same damn way, so I thought... Yeah,
you just said...
the opposite. They both were...
You said this is Mr. Kip to Ned.
Oh, duh, I'm sorry. You're not going to believe this. Just now I was closing down the store when I heard a dull scratching sound come from the wall behind the register. Remember last spring when the rats got in the walls? It sounded like that, so I headed to the basement to get the traps. I was only away for a few seconds, but when I came back upstairs, the hermit was in the store again. He was scrapping something along with the wall with a rusty old knife. I hollered at him to cut it out. He stopped, but he didn't even apologize. Just turned around and demanded that I sell him a shovel because she needed his basement to be deeper.
Is this like Blair Witch?
Can't believe a guy like that managed to land himself a wife. I had him pay extra on account of the damage he did to the wall. Looks like he carved a bunch of stick figures. Would you mind painting over those when you get a chance? I'd do it myself right now, but it's late and I've frankly got a pretty bad case of the heebie-jeebies just looking at the things right now.
So that's definitely Carver.
Yeah, it must
possibly
be.
With the Blair Witch.
This is Mr. Kip from Ned. Guess I can just use this sheet as a running log of hermit updates. He visited again towards closing today. He said he needed an extra pair of hands to help him with a project because it needed to be done fast. Offered me a good amount of money to help him out on my day off from the store tomorrow, and I said yes. Thought I'd let you know just in case, and don't worry. I'll be bringing back my hunting knife just in case he's really as off as rocker as people around town say. Off as rocker. I haven't heard that in forever.
There's a bunch of arrows.
Yeah, this is like, pay attention to it. Mr. Kip to Ned. I know it's my day off, but I stopped by to tell you to...
Ned to Mr. Kip.
Did I say opposite again?
No.
Tell you to ban that hermit from the store. Guess you're on your lunch break, but listen, this man's a menace. I met up with him on the edge of the forest at sunrise today to walk up to his house. We started on the path to the lumber mill, but soon veered off from that path entirely. We walked in one direction for what I would judge to be 5 hours. As we walked, the hermit would occasionally mutter under his breath to himself, like he'd completely forgotten that I was there at all. I could barely hear what he was saying, but I thought that I could make out something about heading toward the Hoard of Bones.
Oh!
Here's
Hoard of Bones. Literally, okay. Hoard of Bones. So they
did walk straight. Yep.
They went
right.
One, two, three, four, five.
Okay.
Hoard of Bones. So
we eventually reached a stream, and when we did, it was like he suddenly remembered that I existed again. He turned to me and he started talking about how there's a part of the forest where she pinned the shadows in place with pine needles.
Hang on.
I know. I remember it. Yep.
That's somewhere, but let me find it.
I think it's up there.
Shadows stay confined in place, right there.
Yeah, in place with pine needles. And that he made sure to build his place as far away from them as he could. He said that his cabin was another 3 hours down the river, away from the still shadows. He told me that I should count myself lucky that I wouldn't have to see those shadows just yet.
Wait.
Read that again?
3 hours away.
Mm-hmm.
From what shadows?
I'm just backing up. And that he made sure that he'd build his place as far away from them as he could. He said that his cabin was another 3 hours down the river, away from the still shadows.
Another 3 hours down the river.
Away from the still shadows.
And each square is an hour.
So wait.
This is shadow.
Maybe that's just confusing words. Another 3 hours away...
from the Still Shadows.
So say they're here. One, two, three.
That's what I was going to say.
I just got confused.
And I think that the scratching thing, maybe it's a hint as, like, this is the row. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, it brings you over here, but, like, seven is the row.
Well, when you were reading, I ended up here.
Yeah.
Now we are one, two, three. We're right here. Okay.
Maybe it was just because I was spooked, but in the moment, it sure as heck sounded like a threat. I made some excuse about forgetting that my ma wanted me home by lunch and said that I couldn't help him out with his repairs after all. Then I all but ran back to town. I just thought you should know that I'm not going to be serving him anymore. If he comes into the store again, I'm just going to hide out in the basement until he leaves. I know that's not very professional, but it's the only thing I think I'll be able to do if I see him again, and that's the God honest truth. I'll see you tomorrow, Mr. Kip.
And that's that.
So this is Carver building a house. Is Rosemary Blair Witch?
Remember how...
Oh, so this is his crib that he's seen that he took him to or something?
Yeah, he said he window drew
in the attic. She wants me to build. She told
stick
me the
build,
spot.
Stone foundation. She wants
plaster
a basement.
Interior.
She expects company soon.
I bet you the answer to this is R7.
Huh?
You think the answer is R7?
Yeah. Because I'm a genius and I solved the last one by being a genius.
R7.
Yeah.
That's where I ended last time, but that's not where I ended with you.
That's where you ended with mine, and mine seems too simple because
I ended with you here, so it's probably between.
Somewhere
we're gonna find
it.
Out where that one's gonna take us.
Do more fucking reading.
I can do it. End it. All right, take it off.
The Execution of the Blair Witch, written by Anthony Ravenel. Act 1, Scene 5. This script is a section of a historical play that I staged a few years ago, titled "The Past Never Dies," a first-person anthology of tales from the old Blair. This particular scene is a dramatization of the Honorable Judge Jonathan Goodneighbor's journal entries written just a few months before his death in 1785. Goodneighbor's journal was originally found in the walls of a museum during HUD's renovations. A rat had made its nest out of the pages, but the few sections that were still legible had provided a fascinating insight into the trial and condemnation of the alleged Blair Witch. While the lack of concrete information regarding the accused witch's death, those particular pages having been long since lost, forced me to take a number of creative liberties and make some educated guesses. All the information on the directions that Good Neighbor took in the forest itself are accurate to the history. Anthony. Act 1, Scene 5. Interior, Judge Good Neighbor's quarters, afternoon. Good Neighbor paces on the floor of his bedroom and crosses to his desk. Sitting, he prepares his journal and writes, "Good Neighbor, writing weary. This is the journal of Jonathan Goodneighbor, recorded this horrid evening, February 17th, 1785. The townsfolk complain of witchcraft. Many children bear the same mark on their wrist from where she carved in siphoned blood. It was told to me that she collected the blood into several small bowls and arranged them in her cellar into some satanic symbol. I, being a godly man, as well a man of the law, ordered an investigation to be conducted at once. An hour's walk into the forest, we discovered an old woman's home, encircled with fencing of wood bound in twine. Rushing inside into the fruit cellar, we found her standing in the corner, as if expecting our arrival. I saw no sign of the ritual and no evidence of her working her craft. It made no difference. She had ample time to conceal her doings, and the children's testimony was damning enough. We bound the hag in shackles and carried her to meet justice." Good Neighbor leans back in his chair, deep in thought. He stands crossing the window to stare out at the town. "Good Neighbor," a loud foreboding. "We must put this witch on trial and submit her to punishment with utmost haste. Blackout." And there's a photo of what I believe is the witch on trial.
An hour into the forest, she was just standing in the corner of her basement waiting.
Yep, that's what he said. Interior, Judge Goodneighbor's quarters, night. Goodneighbor angrily storms into the room. It is dimly lit by a single candle. A storm rages outside the window. His desk is cluttered with books. He sweeps his arm across the tabletop, throwing the mess onto the floor. He sits and furiously begins to write. Goodneighbor, writing. February 21st, 1785. Though the children of Blair exposed her deeds, the old woman had nothing to say on the matter. Even when I bellowed her in a most thunderous voice to reveal her true purpose, she said nothing. Finally, I was left with no option but to take a hot poker to her skin. a reminder of the everlasting hellfire which awaits all those who refuse to repent. She did not so much as flinch. Nor mortal could have withstood the searing pain of that fire, and so it was proven in her silence that she was indeed wed to the devil. The trial was complete. The windows blow open, extinguishing good neighbor's candle. The stage is dark. Good neighbor, shocked. Damned storm. A flash of lightning briefly illuminates the room, revealing an old woman watching good neighbor as he closes the window. He doesn't seem to notice her. The room returns to darkness, and when good neighbor relights his candle, she's gone. He continues. Good neighbor, writing. As I delivered the sentence, I expected some cry or protestation, and yet she sat staring at the wall with unfocused eyes. Come the morning, my companions and I shall bring the witch to a quiet place to carry out her sentencing. With a heavy sigh, good neighbor lays down his quill. Blackout. Interior. Judge good neighbor's quarters. Day. Good neighbor appears exhausted. He has heavy red scratches on the left side of his face and neck. His robes are torn and his boots are muddy. Good neighbor writing, February 22nd, 1785. And so the courts have done their work and the law has been upheld. Desiring to place distance between ourselves and the fair town, we traveled until we came upon a huge bone-white rock. I suggested that we complete the deed there, and it seemed as good a spot as any. However, we soon began to hear a terrible noise, the sound of hundreds of crows calling in the distance. I judged the birds to be an hour from our position at the rock, but their cries echoed in the most loud and ominous manner. Doubtless an omen. As they crowed in the distance, we pummeled the witch as punishment for summoning the beast. She still made no sound. Though the witch was silent, the forest was not. The sound of cawing crows still echoed from a particular region of the forest itself, as if the land had taken on the cries of the birds and amplified them a hundredfold. As the others clutched their ears in pain and fear, I found myself clutching at my greatest comfort, a locket containing a lock of my dear wife Propriety's hair, and to compose myself as I recited the Lord's Prayer. That's like what half of the stuff in the town's named of it, isn't it?
What?
Like good proprietary.
But no. The code. Find us where a shred of propriety was lost.
Oh. As the others clutched their ears in pain and fear, I found myself clutching at comfort a locket containing my dear wife's hair, and it was at the White Rock. So maybe this, if that is...
No, well, he went to the White Rock, or did they go somewhere? Because this is the crows?
No, they...
The crows feed at blood red dusk. This is the crows.
The White Rock is where they killed her or pummeled her.
Okay, just keep reading.
Unwilling to remain in the same vicinity as the beast, we turned from our position at the rock and fled for 5 hours in total, going the opposite direction from which the cacophonous cawing had so ominously emanated. Jesus.
So while from where the ravens were, 5 away from them, 5 hours.
While we fled the noise, I noted that a certain region of the forest contained a number of trees that appeared to have been ravaged by a large creature of some sort, and I warned my men to keep their wits about them.
What does it say?
This is where the trees got ravaged.
I was quite relieved when we left this particular area behind us. Our group continued straight forward on the course we had set away from the terrible noises.
So how many hours did they go away from the crows?
5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Okay.
This is that one.
When the last sounds of the crows had faded and the forest was silent as the grave, save for the sounds of our party's footsteps, the witch finally broke her days-long silence. She requested that where she be left to die, she would be left in a grove of trees that she often sat amongst in moments of silent contemplation. We, being an honorable and compassionate group of men, obliged. She turned at a slight angle and led us in a new direction. With myself directly at her back,
angle,
yeah,
keeping a keen eye out for any sign of treachery and any men behind me. As we walked, I began to hear behind me my men murmur dreadful utterances about how we and our children would be doomed for our trespassing and violence. I turned and ordered them to be quiet, but each and every man insisted...
Murmurs.
Each and every man insisted that they had not uttered a word. After traveling for 2 hours in the witch's chosen direction, we came upon a hollow with a white tree at its center.
A hollow with a
white tree. Two, three, four, five, going at a slight angle. Because this is the murmurs. I want put you this way. Like, going like this, and that's next to it. This is the murmurs.
I moved to bind the witch to the tree, a twisted dying thing. Seeking out one final opportunity to set her bloodlust,
The witch clawed my face and neck as I bound her, screeching all manner of hellish condemnation and tearing the locket from my neck. It was then that my companions fled,
that's
leaving me
to
carry out...
No, where he lost a locket, because that's the prop... whatever.
Leaving me to carry out the deed on my own. Perhaps they feared she would soon break free of her bindings, so I was left alone to complete the task. Her strength surprised me, but the power of all that is holy remained on my side, and I succeeded in my efforts to subdue her. I completed the deed, and so full of fear that I momentarily forgot about the locket, turned my back on the witch to return home. As I left the hollow, I began to feel an agonizing sensation of burning on the back of my neck, as if two hot coals had been pressed into my flesh. I did not turn around to see what was behind me. Instead, I began to run back in town, not slowing or turning back for once the entire journey. Regretfully, I must leave behind my beloved locket. A fear grips me that, should I attempt to return the forest again, I might not return home. From outside the window, the figure of an old woman in a dark and heavy cloak slowly approaches, watching Good Neighbor. Good Neighbor writing. I comfort myself with the knowledge that the witch's twisted heart will lie far away from the civilized society forevermore. Still, I confess that I cannot forget the sound of her final cries and the terrible curse she uttered with her last gasping breath. But I comfort myself with the knowledge that, at last, this horridness is behind us. The old woman stands staring in through the window, no longer at Judge Good Neighbor, but the audience. Blackout. Okay, so we've taken into account of... who is this guy that's walking through the forest? The sheriff or whatever?
Mm-hmm. Good Neighbor.
Yeah, so... Yeah.
We ended up tracing everything back. Crows are here at P2. The part of the woods that's messed up with carvings and stuff was L2. And then the murmurs was I3. And then he went from crows this way at a diagonal through the murmurs. I think it was 2 hours, right?
Yeah.
Which would end us at H4. So we made a little mark on the map there.
And then the code that you deciphered said what?
Find us where a shred of propriety was lost, which was the...
And that seems like
the wife's hair.
Yeah, that's what it made it sound like. That's the lock.
But just as a little other thing, the hermit, which could possibly be Carver, we marked that on the map too when he took a little walk with the kid, which they went up to the Horde of Bones, which was 07, and then went this way for a little bit, and it put us at R7. So we're going to try R7 or H4.
Sure. We're thinking that...
One or the other.
Yeah, because we... Because
technically,
they
want to know where Carver's hiding spot is, which maybe he's in his cabin.
Right.
But the
we
code
also
wanted
to figure
us...
out this code, man.
Yeah.
We want to figure... Any bit of the code, we always want to figure it out.
So we're going to try both.
Are you logged into the website, bud? Or are we going to tell Rosemary...
I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to go with my guess first, if that's okay.
H4.
Okay? So H4 is my guess.
I'm assuming that H4 is probably it, because they...
That's the propriety.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And that's what I want it to be the right answer. So. All right,
we have an answer.
It was right. Was it right, dude? Oh,
stick
my
with
goodness.
Me. Stick with me.
So then the cabin...
You guessed R7 at the start of this.
I did.
Don't let him edit it out.
But I changed my answer.
Don't let him edit it out. He's like, brain blast, R7.
Listen,
it's over.
I changed it.
We definitely almost got misled, and someone may have not thought it was the wrong answer, but it's okay.
This one went like
yeah,
a
it
big
did.
Circle.
Big old.
I don't know.
All right, let's hear it.
Stop with all
dude,
the
you
reading.
Broke.
Yeah, I didn't
what
want to
you
say
dude,
that.
I was no, it was weak. I'm not gonna say that I shouldn't have done that, but I'm gonna say it was
dude,
weak.
You're getting Liam a new company.
All right, let's listen.
Good. I've been waiting out here for a few hours. Something told me that you'd find me the answers that I needed today. Now I know where to go. Thank you. Whoa, hold on, boy. Hold on, let me get my bag.
He said, whoa, boy.
You know, it's kind of a relief to be out here. The house is... unbearable. It's so quiet. And I hate being at the Silver Moon. I can't stand the looks everyone gives me. More and more lately, I've just been staring out into the woods, or reading about the woods. Or sitting up in the middle of the night thinking about the woods. I know, buddy, I know.
Tank.
He seems antsy. I hope he'll be able to pick up a scent. I've noticed when I come out here to search for the boys that the further you go in, the quieter it gets. It's not a peaceful quiet, though. It's tense. Like the whole forest is holding its breath. Hud and I would come out here sometimes when we were first started dating. He knew all kinds of facts about nature. Moss grows on the north side of a tree, he'd say. I have no idea if that's actually true. We used to chase each other around and leave each other these little notes. And then a few years later, down the road, Hud started bringing Liam to cut wood with him until... until I lost him to this place. Oh, I'm going to get my sons out of here. Even if I have to end up just like Hud to do it. Goodbye for now.
Damn you!
I have a feeling that's the last we heard of Rosemary.
That was super sad, Holmes.
That was
now we're going to talk to Anthony.
Super, super sad, Holmes.
Yeah, that was tough, but... Well, goddamn, we gave her what she wanted to know. Another successful episode.
I don't know how to feel now.
I mean, I don't either, but we're going to find out next time we open the box, right?
Yeah, next one we open.
It'll tell us how to feel, and that's what we love about this game.
Next one, the last one of this season?
There's two more.
There's two more this season, yeah, okay. So we got a little bit of juice left, and then we still got a second season. So we got,
This game makes me feel like such an idiot, but such a genius.
It makes you feel like a jackass until you get it, and you're like, man, I've been seven. I've been the smartest dude since this game started.
All right, well, like always, if you guys like this content, make sure you like and subscribe for more. Thank you guys for joining us on this weird journey that we're on with Blair Witch. And we'll see you guys next time. Yosin out.
Yosin out.